Hello F11 members and welcome to the Fundamentals of Post-Production video tutorials for issue 60, January 2017. Okay, on the screen in front of you, you've got a picture of Dancing Ledge on the Jurassic Coast, which I shot just a few days ago. You can read in the How It's Done feature how that shoot all came together. But what I'd like to go through is the post-production of this picture here. On the left, you see the image straight out of the camera. Got some really nice wave motion in the water there, which I really like the shape of that. Nevertheless, the picture itself is dull and flat and really quite unappealing. The light is boring. But I've experimented with converting it to black and white, and I think managed to produce something with a fair bit of impact. So let's go through what I've done there. So the first thing I'm going to do is just go back into library mode here. And now we're going to go up to the develop module and look at it full screen. And let's just reset that picture to where I started. And the first thing I do when I'm thinking of doing a black and white image is go through up here. You've got Lightroom's black and white filter presets. And essentially, if you just hover your cursor over each option, you can see a preview of it top left of what it's going to do, what those presets do. And in this particular case, I've gone for the infrared option. So if I click on that, now that produces a picture which is looking tremendously low contrast, really lacking in any kind of impact. But what drew me to this particular preset was the fact that we've got some interesting tones here in the rocks. It's lightened that detail quite a bit and darkened the blue in the water. And I think with a bit of skillful post-production, we can introduce the contrast and impact that I need to. So let's start. And the first thing I'm going to do is look at, as usual, my black and my white points. So I'm going to alter my black points here by holding down the Alt key and moving the black slider to the left. And I'm gonna sacrifice a little bit of shadow detail there by going to minus 50 on my blacks. It's blocking in a few shadows in this, deep in that black area there, but really, that's fine. There's nothing wrong with a pure black as long as it doesn't dominate the shadow areas. Okay, now this is going to do the same with the white points. So again, hold down the Alt slider and move the whites to the right until I start to clip my white points there. And I can go all the way to about plus 48. Okay, so next thing I'm going to do is actually add some clarity. Now this is, the infrared preset has actually taken clarity out of the picture to give it that almost diffuse feel that traditional infrared pictures have. But in fact, I'm going to go the other way and introduce clarity. I don't tend to use clarity much at all in my color work, but I think for black and white, it can be really quite useful. And if you can see, if I go way over, it starts introducing local contrast here in the rocks, in particular on the left of the frame. I think that's way too far, quite frankly. So I'm going to come around back to about plus 40 on the clarity slider there. Okay, well, already the picture is starting to look a lot better than how we started. I think generally speaking, overall, the image is a bit too bright. Now, the infrared black and white preset that I chose has put this strong contrast curve in on the tone curve. which is fine. I'm not going to touch that. I'm just going to use my exposure slider to pull back the overall darkness of the picture just a touch to about minus 30 there. Okay, now the next thing I'm going to look at is the general overall contrast of the picture itself. Again, that's been put in with the tone curve. A strong tone curve has given the image contrast. I'm going to go even more. I'm going to go just dial in about plus, quite a bit really. But these plus 20 to start with. Let's see how we go with that. I tend to do far more extreme adjustments in black and white than I ever do in color, by the way. Okay, but the picture is starting to have the kind of feel and look that I want, but the sky is lacking in bottle, in any kind of drama at all. The detail is there though, so I'm going to use the grad tool here to bring something into that sky there. So if I hold down the shift key on my keyboard here and pull the grad down from the top, it keeps it level. How soft I want this grad to be will be determined now, but of course I can come back and tweak it subsequently. I'm going to run it round about there. Now, if you can see here, if I come down and click on that show selected mask overlay, click on that, it shows in red where my grad is going to be effective. Now I don't want it to be effective on the cliffs here. So what I'm going to do here is come over to the brush tool within the grad tool adjustments, click on erase down here, make sure auto mask is set. Can then, and feather is at the maximum of 100. Now move over here and I can see my brush tool indicated there, and I can adjust the size of that brush using the square bracket keyboard. The inner circle says where the brush starts and the outer circle where the feathering ends. So there's a soft edge to that. By the way, if you're using an Apple as I am and you've got a magic mouse, you can also adjust the size of the brush by stroking your your magic mouse. Moving your finger up and down on your magic mouse will have the effect of adjusting the size of your brush. Okay, I'm now gonna erase away that mask on the cliffs there. Okay, and now I'm going to come back, unclick that show selected mask overlay control, and now I'm going to adjust the amount, what I want to do to the sky here. And so as you can see, it's affecting the grad tool is affecting the sky and not the cliffs there. Very, very useful, very powerful tool this. So I'm going to dial in on the grad about how far to go. I don't want to make it look too obvious here. So I'm going to go about minus 70 on my exposure, and I'm going to put a fair bit of contrast into that sky as well. Come back on my exposure a bit, fine-tune that, a bit more on my contrast in that sky there. Move the grad down a touch, and that's looking pretty good, don't you think? Come click on that, click on done there, and looking at the histogram, I can see I've got a complete range of tones there. What I'm going to do actually just is use the adjustment brush here now, this tool up here on the right. So I'm going to click on the adjustment brush, and I'm going to click again on the show selected mask overlay, and now I'm going to adjust the size of my brush so it's quite small. And what I'm doing here is I just want to pull back some of this detail here in the brightest part of the waves, just in this area here. So I'm just going to paint in that area now. Okay, and Now if I click on show selected mask off, and now I can come here and pull back the highlights in that area, and also the exposure, pull back the exposure, not obviously not too much, else it will look much too obvious. So just a touch, really subtle adjustment here, around about minus 26 there, does nicely. Add a bit of contrast, and that's just put a bit of tone and detail into that bright area of the waves there. Click on done now. Look, stand back and look at the picture and ask myself, how's it looking? I'm fairly pleased with that image. Now I need to add some sharpening. So I go sharpen scenic here, as usual. Use the Lightroom preset, come down to my masking tool here, select, hold down Alt, move masking to the right until the mask is being applied to the area of the sky, around about plus 20 there, and that's my sharpening done. So let's have us just step back and consider where we got to with this picture. If I now zoom in, you can see the detail is really quite impressive. I love these tones here in the rocks there. And if we again have a look at where we started and where we finished, that's it. So to recap, I selected the in the Lightroom black and white presets, the infrared option, and then fine-tuned my contrast and clarity and used the grad tool to bring the sky in, and that's the end result. Bit of fun, and as always, black and white just can look so moody and so give an image so much impact, and I'm really quite pleased with this picture. Okay, that's it. We'll see you in part two of the fundamentals of post-production video tutorials.